意大利大选变数丛生，反欧党异军突起，欧盟会否再受冲击？
One of the parties in Italy that is also running for the election is suggesting another currency.
Today, the euro is a reality. It would be rather complicated to imagine another currency.
中国欧盟旅游年再一启动，五思路上响起新口令。
The idea of visiting China is getting more and more and more appealing.
风云对话，专访意大利驻华大使谢国。在日前召开的中意政府委员会第八次联席会议上，中国外长王毅和意大利外长阿尔法诺签署了中意共建“一带一路”政府间合作文件，提出传承古代丝绸之路精神，共建“一带一路”。在“一带一路”框架下，近年来两国领导人频繁互访。2017年2月，意大利总统马塔雷拉应邀访华期间，双方签署了包括科技、基础设施等方面的合作协议，两国元首也就中意关系发展达成重要共识。
So, Ambassador Sequi, retrospectively, how do you summarize the Italian diplomatic work in 2017 in China?
Well, it was a spectacular year under the point of view of our bilateral relationships. We had the visit of our President of the Republic, of our Prime Minister, who came for the Belt and Road Forum in May. We had the visit of six ministers, so one ministerevery 2 months. Our Vice Minister for External Trade has visited China 10 times in 12 months. Several very important Chinese guests have visited Italy. Last one was Vice Premier Mackay, who visited Rome in the month of December. It was really a very important year.A couple of years ago, we celebrated the 45th anniversary of our diplomatic relations, and we decided to find a way to translate this important political input into concrete output. How? We elaborated a concept, a road, a vision, I would say, which we called Road to 50, which is the common trip that China and Italy should do towards the 50th anniversary of our diplomatic relations in 2020, 2020, which coincides with the end of the five-year program. So we decided together to travel together in order to cooperate, in particular in the fields which are priorities for the five-year program, in order to celebrate at best the 5th anniversary of our diplomatic relations.
2008年金融危机以来，意大利遭遇了连续5年的经济衰退，这也是意大利自二战以来遭受的时间最长的经济衰退。在此期间，意大利的失业率从2007年的最低点5.7%上升至2014年的最高点13%，贫困人口增加了3倍，达到470万人，并引发了一系列的社会问题。而在此次金融危机中，困扰意大利的另一个问题就是银行债务危机。数据显示，2016年意大利债务占国内生产总值比率高达133%，是欧元区债务比例最高的国家之一。连年高企的债务让意大利脆弱的经济雪上加霜。2016年12月，意大利通过政府救助法案，豪掷200亿欧元援助银行业。而意大利总理珍蒂洛尼上任以来，更是采取多项改革措施，使意大利经济逐年好转。
How's the economy of Italy in 2017 and predictably in 2018?
Well, we are quite happy about, the status of our economy. Actually, Italy has undergone a series of structural reforms in the last 3 or 4 years. Very important reforms which have made Italy a better place where to invest, a more efficient place, a more efficient economy, I would say. So a number of structural reforms have impacted in a very beneficial way on economy. For example, economy has gained strength, production has increased, trade, we were talking about China, but I mean, this is a general trend that we have experienced also in other countries. Trade is going really very well. we have a sound primary surplus, and we are basically reducing our debt. This is very important because...
Well, speaking of the debts, I would say that the public debts, the figure is sort of concerning, isn't it? It's 130% of the GDP.
We have stabilized the debt to GDP ratio.
And so what it's is stabilized?
Yes.
And what at is, a high level?
No, it is decreasing. But what is important, and this is not really known by many, is that the GDP has increased, and at the same time the primary balance has improved. We have in Europe only another country which was able to do the same, which is Germany. Other countries, other European countries, for example, had a slightly better performance in terms of GDP growth, but with a negative primary balance. What does it mean? It means that we were able to find the right trade-off between increasing the GDP at the same time stabilizing and eventually decreasing the GDP to debt ratio, which is definitely a positive achievement, which was acknowledged by several international financial institutions.
2017年12月28日，意大利总统马塔雷拉正式解散议会，标志着意大利大选正式拉开帷幕。有别于以往，此次大选将首次采用2017年10月通过的新选举法，算法更加复杂。不少分析人士认为，选举中可能会出现三党派三分天下的局面，产生悬浮议会，并使意大利陷入数月的政治僵局。
So there's a general election coming up. Can you please tell us about it?
Well, on the 4th of March, we shall have the general elections. After 5 years, so I mean, we did not have any early elections. We are going to elect 630 deputies. We have a bicameral system, a lower house with 630 deputies and upper house, the Senate, 315. So we shall see what will be the result. What I can say is that there is a strange stereotype that the Italian political system sometimes is not particularly stable. I would say on the opposite. The performance of the economy is the proof that the political system is working properly. And I believe that this is a trend that we shall see also after the elections.
So you don't see the instability of the political system?
Definitely, it is a very stable country. And I also believe that the results of the good performance in terms in economic terms is a proof that the system is very solid, and whatever will be the result, the positive trend of our economy will continue.
So in the several months up until the election, usually there are a lot of debates, arguments, etc. And sometimes, I mean, in often cases, that some of the arguments are related to the foreign policies with China. Is it the case in Italy this time?
Well, I believe that the issue of foreign policy, yes, is very important in every country, I think, during an election, but mostly. The core issue of debate is economy, is internal politics. Nevertheless, we are also very consistent on one thing. Italy wishes to be a strategic partner of China. We are going to celebrate in 2020 our 50th anniversary, and what we see increasingly is an improvement of our relationship, and this is rather clear. The second point is that, and I assess this in a very positive way, China is famous for its long-term vision. The vision of China, in also geopolitical terms, is long. But what we are seeing is that the vision of China is becoming increasingly deeper and wider. And I believe this is a very good news. So we wish to be an even better partner for China and with China in a long vision, but also in a deeper and wider vision.
有句闻名世界的谚语说，条条大路通罗马。在通往罗马的众多道路中，最显著的一条就是横跨欧亚大陆，连接古代东西方文明的古代丝绸之路。无论是横跨欧亚的陆上丝路，还是远涉重洋的海上丝路，盛极一时的古罗马帝国都是其中不可或缺的一环。而今时今日，地处于地中海交通枢纽的意大利，也是一带一路版图上的重要一站。
So how is China's Belt and Road Initiative viewed by your country?
Very positively. Actually, we believe that this is a very pioneering and visionary initiative. Italy has supported this initiative since the very beginning. I could mention the fact that, for example, my country is a founding member of the AIIB. But apart from that, during the visit of our President of the Republic in February 2017, he was very vocal and very clear, both in the private meetings but also in public, for example, lectures at universities, to support Belt and Road. He even launched an idea, Belt and Road or New Silk Road of Knowledge, because Belt and Road, it is about economy, it is about infrastructure, it is about trade, but it is also about people to people. And our Prime Minister, who was he was very happy to be invited at the Belt and Road Forum in May. Our Prime Minister was the only Prime Minister of a G7 country. And that very moment, in that particular moment, Italy was holding the chairmanship, the presidency of the G7. We definitely support Belt and Road, and we wish to be a part of that. Why? Not only for historical reasons. I mean, Italy was the terminal of the old Silk Road, but also for very objective reasons. For example, the system of the Italian ports is the ideal, I would say, the ideal terminal of the maritime Belt and Road. Trieste, Venice, but also Genoa, are basically in the middle of Europe already. And they are very well connected through a network of rails and roads. Let me say also that we believe that our ports are complementary, not conflicting, but complementary with Piraeus. I could also mention the fact that Italy has bought the Greek railroad, so we are very happy for Piraeus to develop the connections by rail with the center of Europe. But our ports are already there, closer to Europe and already very well connected.
2017年3月25日，欧盟27国领导人聚首罗马市政厅广场，纪念罗马条约签署60周年。
The unity of Europe is not a bureaucratic model. It is a set of common values and democratic standards.
60年前，这里曾经见证了被视作是欧洲一体化进程的重要里程碑的罗马条约的签署。这一条约的签署标志着欧盟的前身，欧洲共同体的诞生。60年前，罗马条约为饱经二战苦难的欧洲带来了和平，而60年后，今时今日的欧盟却面临着难民危机、恐怖主义、经济困难、民粹势力等一系列新的挑战。 意大利是欧盟中地位举足轻重的创始国之一。然而近年来，长期的经济停滞和非法移民等问题，使得意大利对欧盟的态度发生了一些变化。此次意大利大选中，在民调中处于领先地位的五星运动党，就呼吁意大利对于放弃欧元进行公投。对于这个问题，曾经处使布鲁塞尔多年的谢国誼大使，在采访中又是怎么说的呢？
In 2017, you celebrated the 60th anniversary of the signing of the Treaty of Rome. And in 2018, that you're going to have the first ever in many years, the general election in your country, which is viewed by some a big testimony for the stability and the solidarity of European Union. How do you look at this?
In a way, a bit, probably a bit biased. The reason being that I've been ambassador of the European Union as well, and I worked overall for Brussels for 5 years. I believe that European Union is extremely important for all member countries, but also for the stability of the world. We mentioned before the financial crisis of 2009. Well, in the financial crisis, what was really extremely important for Europe was to have the safety network of represented by the EU and by the euro, the common currency that a number of European countries share. What impressed me a lot when I was ambassador of the European Union in a country which aspired to become a European Union member was that those who do not belong to European Union are really pushing to get in. Why? I was very much impressed by that. And the answer was very simple, because from outside they see all the benefits that the membership of European Union can bring. We should not forget also that more in general, the European Union is probably the most important experiment of political engineering that we had in history. And it is an experiment which has brought not only prosperity, but also peace.
Now how about the other side of the scene, that the members are already inside?
It is a strange time. Most of the generations who are in the European Union have not experienced the tragedy of the war. So they even don't know what does it mean to be obliged to get the visa to go, for example, from Italy to Germany, or from Belgium to France. They don't know, because they never experienced that. Still, today, the European Union is a common space where people can move freely with no visa, where services can move equally freely.
One of the parties in Italy that is also running for the election is suggesting another currency instead of euros. How feasible it would be?
One of the most important concepts in the European Union is united in diversity. That means that diversity is not necessarily something wrong. Diversity means also that we can have different ideas, but all contributions are welcomed. Today, the euro is a reality, and it would be rather complicated to imagine another currency.
色彩的海边村落，蜿蜒妩媚的水上之城，古罗马的灿烂历史，文艺复兴的硕果杰作， 丰富的旅游资源让意大利像是一本厚重的书，吸引了大批游客的瞩目。一直以来，意大利也是备受中国游客喜爱的欧洲旅游目的地之一。意大利已经成为中国游客的第二大欧洲旅游目的地国，也是中国游客境外消费最多的欧洲国家。1月19日，2018中国欧盟旅游年在意大利威尼斯正式拉开帷幕，而意大利作为欧洲传统的旅游胜地，在此契机下也推出了友好举措，促使意大利旅游持续升温。
2018 is the EU-China Tourism Year, and it's getting launched in Italy, in Venice. So how is Italy getting prepared for this special year?
This is not a coincidence. This is a very important celebration, a very important event, and it is not a coincidence that this launch will take place in Venice. Let's not forget that Marco Polo comes from Venice, and let's not forget that Marco Polo was probably one of the most renowned travelers or tourists crossing all the borders and joining China and Europe, I would say, and particularly Italy in that moment. So we attach the greatest importance to this meeting, to this event. We know that today China is a superpower also in tourist terms. In terms of expenditure, it is the most important country in the world, and in terms of outbound tourists, is the second most important country. But let's not also forget that China is becoming increasingly a destination of tourism for foreign tourists. I can see it easily, for example, in Italy, tourism, the idea of visiting China is getting more and more and more appealing. So I believe that this year will be extremely important for boosting the concept of tourism in the two directions. They are very proud, very happy.
And apart from this, what are other goals of this tourism year?
Tourism means many things. Tourism means economic flows, means prosperity, means developing also air connections, all kind of people-to-people relationship. And this, I think, is very consistent with the idea of Belt and Road, because, as I said, Belt and Road is also a tool for connecting people. The magic word, connectivity, means many things, including connecting people. As far as we are concerned, for us, this is an extremely important year in terms of linking Italy and China under the point of view of tourism.
地处南欧半岛，终年阳光明媚，孕育了意大利人豪迈爽朗、乐观热情的性格，以及崇尚自由、享受生活的人生态度。正如法国学者丹娜在19世纪60年代写就的美学著作《艺术哲学》中所言，意大利人对生活的理解就是一场欢乐的节日盛宴，不到迫不得已，绝不操心其他事情。意大利还是美食文化的强势主流，被誉为欧洲大陆烹饪之始祖，丰富的食材和高超的厨艺支撑这个令人垂涎的美食帝国。有人说，世界上可以与中国餐馆在数量与受欢迎度上并驾齐驱的，就只有意大利餐馆。精美可口的面食、奶酪、火腿，让意大利成为世界各国美食家向往的天堂。对于热爱生活的意大利人，美食早已超越了口腹之欲，成为意式生活中一个必不可少的元素。
So being Italian ambassador to China, how do you see the similarities or even commonalities of the Italian and Chinese cultures?
I see a lot. First of all, and this is quite obvious, I would say that both China and Italy are two cultural superpowers. I wouldn't say the only ones, but I would say probably most important ones. This is recognized by the fact that we have launched together a kind of unique and I would say visionary initiative, which is twinning not cities but twinning UNESCO sites. Italy and China have the highest number of UNESCO sites by far in the world. So we have the knowledge. We know that we are very much aware that we have a history, and which is a common history, not only from the times of Matelot or Marco Polo, but from before, from the times of the Roman Empire already. The second thing is that we see the life probably in the same way. We love, for example, quality. We love family. In fact, the importance that we attach to food is probably linked to the conviviality that we love and that we like to have in our families, with our friends. This is, I think, something that I found in my experience, I could say, long experience as a diplomat, only in Italy and mostly, I would say not only, but mostly in Italy and China. This year, 2018, will be the year of food, Italian food, also in terms of culture. My prime minister very wisely says, wherever in the world you go, from Samoa to United States, from Luxembourg to Chile, you always will find Italian restaurants and Chinese restaurants. So I think that this is also in terms of promotion of the bilateral links, this will be a very important year.
Just a side question, do you think the Italians know better how to enjoy the leisure of time?
I think that Italians are rather professional in doing that, and I believe that this is also another reason why we like each other.
What a beautiful feeling.
Yeah.
In the new year of the dog, my best wishes to you, to Phoenix TV, all the viewers, to all the friends, this beautiful sheep which represents the friendship between Italy and China, hopefully in the framework of the maritime Belt and Road.